All right, Mark Rogers TV, the voice of college football, talking college football unlike anybody else. Best discussion, debate, and analysis you'll find anywhere. And for the first time here, we've got Vernon Speaks Sports.
What's going on, Mark?
Vernon, how you doing there?
I'm doing incredible this afternoon. I've got a lot of work in today and excited to be a part of your show. I think you get doing some incredible things here, and I would love, I'm excited about the opportunity to talk about Auburn football.
Vernon, I've got to say that in recent weeks, ever since the close of the season and that big romp over Purdue, 63-14, a number, I think I gave Purdue an added touchdown there. I think it was 63-7. Regardless, we've had a lot of people comment that we need more Auburn football coverage.
Oh, yeah,
so
of course,
we have stepped it up in recent weeks, and we appreciate your contribution as well. So before we move ahead to 2019, your thoughts about 2018. My thoughts are basically that Gus Malzahn obviously hit the plains with a big splash in 2013, took a team that was 3-9, 0-8 in the SEC. And I can't think of a bigger turnaround at that level in the history of college football to go from that to within 10 seconds of a national championship win. But it's pretty much leveled off since then. There was the three-week run against Alabama and Georgia in 2017 to get them to the cusp of an SEC championship.
Exactly.
But a lot of 4-5 loss seasons since then. Just your thoughts about Gus Malzahn and how it ended in 2018.
Well, ironically speaking, Gus Malzahn was a part of the national championship team. He was the offensive coordinator back in 2010. And when I look at that particular, I think that started the expectation for the Auburn fan base, winning that national championship in 2010 and then having the opportunity to win another national championship within a 3-year span would have been huge for the Auburn Tigers. And now one thing about it is Auburn, for all intents and purposes, will never gain tangible ground on Alabama when it comes to national championships, when it comes to national notoriety. But that point, that opportunity would have been huge moving forward for the Auburn Tigers. Okay, so you have the missed opportunity in 2013. As you mentioned, you have the 4-5 lost seasons, and then you have the opportunity in 2017, literally staring a national championship. Well, not a national championship, but staring the prospect of being the first two-loss team to enter the college football playoff. But because of, in my opinion, lack of preparation, Kerryon Johnson was clearly hurt, should not have played in that ball game. Squandered that opportunity. Fast forward to now, coming into the 2018 season with, variable expectations, depending on who you ask. The Washington winning that game over Washington set the expectation bar very high for the Auburn Tigers. And then the LSU game was the beginning of the debacle of the 2018 season. Up again, this is why some of the Auburn fans have such a heartburn with Gus Malzahn, is because he casually loses these games like to LSU. That was an inexplicable loss, and that was an unexcusable loss. You're up 21-10 pretty much late in the ball game. You have to have that victory. You have to understand that the Auburn fan base needs these games. They want these games. And then you go into the game against Tennessee, where you have somewhat of a chance to salvage the season, but you pick the time to play arguably one of the worst games in the Gus Malzahn era. Jarrett Stidham, responsible of the future first round draft pick, is responsible for all three of the turnovers in that football game. Auburn loses to what I would like to call a terrible Tennessee team, 30-24. And then one thing I can say about Gus Malzahn and the 2018 season, he did manage to find a way, he and his coaching staff managed to find a way to hold that team together, because a key win in Auburn was that 24-20 win over Texas A&M. That literally saved somewhat, it didn't save the season, but it salvaged in some kind of way the embarrassment of that season and being able to win that football game and, carry, even though kind of fell apart against Georgia in the second half and absolutely collapsed in the middle of the third quarter in the Alabama game. But the game against Purdue solidified what Gus Malzahn's strength is. When I found out that Gus Malzahn was going to be calling plays in that game, I kind of sort of knew how that game was going to go. I actually predicted on a, when I first, because I first started with YouTube around the time that this that game took place. That's when I got really serious about it. I predicted that Auburn would win that game 36-19. I think that's what I predicted. But I figured Auburn would win the game. I figured they would have more solidarity on the offense. I figured that they would, you know, do better with time of possession, which we will talk about as a factor later on in this video. But I think Auburn fans and the Auburn program has reason to at least be casually optimistic. And I say casually because with Auburn, Auburn has one of the toughest schedules in the country, facing Oregon, facing the rigors of the SEC. So you just can't come in this thing and say, okay, Auburn is going to win the SEC championship. I think that's a mindless thing to say, given the rigors of the SEC. So as we go ease into 2019, I think Auburn, I like to say casually optimistic. They don't, you know, right now they don't want to talk too much trash about, yeah, we're going to be great this year. But I think there's some casual optimism on the plains right now.
Talking Auburn football with Vernon Speaks Sports. You can join him right here on YouTube. Just search Vernon Speaks Sports on your YouTube channel here and catch his take on Auburn football. As you mentioned, the Texas A&M game, I watched every play of that game. I felt rather smart for taking Texas A&M, not just with the 3.5 points, but to win the game. And I believe they were up 10 with about 7 minutes left in that game. Then Kellen Mond threw an awful, awful interception as they were down about the 25-30 yard line and could have made a 3-score lead. And I thought right there, mark it down. That's the game changer. And sure enough, Auburn couldn't be stopped on offense the last two drives of the game and won it by 4. The thing I'll get to here, Vernon, is you mentioned the word, and it's the word that bites coaches all over the place in prominent places like Auburn. And the term is expectations.
Right.
So for me, when you mentioned that Auburn won a national championship, of course, with Gene Shizik, then they get back to the BCS championship game with Gus Malzahn, that heightened expectations. For me, knowing Auburn football, having watched Auburn football for longer than I would like to admit, I would think that the expectations for Auburn, for a reasonable fan, would be that you're pumping out 9-3 seasons all the time, 9-3, 9-3. And then every 3 or 4 years, you're jumping up with an 11-1 and you're vying for a college football playoff.
Yes.
But you're generally in the top 15 in the country and you're competing for championships. Obviously, the last 10 years is a bit of an aberration because you have to deal with the most prominent coach in college football and this just ridiculous dynasty at Alabama.
Right.
But for you, what are the expectations at Auburn and what should they be?
I'll tell you what, the current expectation, in my opinion, of Auburn is, you know, after, like I said before, after, because I even coined the phrase the post 2010 fans for Auburn, because after that 2010 season and then being in the national championship again in 2013, that just got Auburn right there. It got them right there at that level of that high level of relevance. Now we're somewhat on the same playing field with Alabama, but within 13 seconds, surrendering that to Florida State. And the Auburn fans have been disgruntled and trying to reach that point ever since, which I think from a realistic standpoint, as you mentioned, I mean, you're still in my stuff, man. As you mentioned, I was actually a student at Auburn. I grew up in the area. I've always been an Auburn fan. And the general expectation is we would get fired up just being ranked, to be fair with you, just to be in the top 20, just to be in the 15, just to have some level of relevance. But I think the expectations at this point have gotten a little on the unrealistic side, and it's causing Auburn fans to really not even enjoy being Auburn fans because they just want something that is probably not going to happen. Now, I'll say this, as you mentioned, 9-3, that's something that is doable for Auburn, and I'm going to tell you why. Auburn, like I said before, has one of the toughest schedules in the country. They have the privilege of having to play Georgia and Alabama guaranteed every year. Those two games are a split or two losses at best. That's two losses right there. You also have the rigors of being in the SEC West. You also have Auburn tends to like to schedule these games like the one they're going to have in the Advocare Classic against Oregon. So you put yourself in a position to where, even though I think Auburn may be in another conference, maybe in the ACC, no disrespect to the ACC, but I think, you know, you put them in the ACC, they could be, they could have more success. But because of where Auburn is proximity wise, always having to face Alabama, in the middle of the recruiting, in a recruiting hotbed between Georgia and Alabama. As a matter of fact, Auburn recruits a lot, especially in the northern Atlanta area, always bumping heads with Georgia. It's just going to be tough for the Auburn fan base to think that Auburn is just going to be a college football, a regular in the college football playoff every year. It's just, you know, just given all the elements involved, it's going to be very difficult, to say the least.
Vernon, I'm going to take your statement and I'm going to solidify it a little bit stronger. If you took Auburn last season and put them in the ACC, obviously, if you put them in one half of the conference, they would have to bump heads with Clemson and nobody right. would have won that battle.
No.
But if you put them in the other side, the Pitt Panthers won the Coastal Division.
Right.
Pitt lost to Penn State by 45 points. They lost to Central Florida by 31 points. They right. they got annihilated by a lot of teams. They lost seven games. The Auburn Tigers would have been the second best team in the ACC. They would have went to the ACC championship game. I would have bet my mortgage on it had they played in the Coastal Division. They most likely would have went 7-1 or 8-0 in the ACC.
Okay, that's fair.
We got Vernon Speaks on the line talking Auburn football. It's Vernon Speaks Sports. Check him out here on YouTube. You say, Vernon, that you've been doing this for about 3 to 4 months?
I've been doing this for about 3 to 4 months on YouTube, but I had a regular thing that I had going on Facebook and finally decided to just say, hey, I want to take this thing seriously. I love Auburn football. I love the competition of college football in general. And it just, it has been a passion of mine. And I finally just said, look, what the hell? Let's go ahead and do this thing.
We got Jarrett Stidham vying for a position in the NFL draft. He's moving on, having had a pretty solid stay for 2 years at Auburn, although he had some detractors as well that expected better play down the stretch in the SEC championship game in the bowl game 2 years ago. And then, of course, they lost five games this past season.
Right.
Now you've got a wide open quarterback situation. Can you kind of handicap where we stand, what you expect, what needs to be determined this spring?
Well, one thing, the good news is Auburn recently hired offensive coordinator Kenny Dillingham. Kenny Dillingham at Memphis was responsible for coaching the quarterbacks, and he did a little stint coaching tight ends as well. One thing I like about Kenny Dillingham and looking at how he approaches the practice field, he's very top heavy on technique. He's very top heavy on making sure that assignments are not missed. And if you listen to his practices, he sets weekly goals to keep his team focused. And he has an unreasonable high level of energy that he brings to the table. And I think teaming this up with Gus Malzahn is going to allow this coaching staff to make an educated decision as to who is going to be the quarterback. Now, I'll go ahead and say this. I think, you know, looking at what Auburn has ahead with facing Oregon, a very high consequence game for the for both teams, actually. And I'm pretty sure both teams are thankful that this game is being played in a neutral site. But that's a whole nother story. But anyway, going into the Oregon game, Auburn probably still will not have a solid answer on who is going to be the starting quarterback for the rest of the season. But because this is such a high consequence game, it adds to the urgency of finding the right guy. And I think Kenny Dillingham, even though he has a limited experience, I think Gus Malzahn obviously having the more experience, I think they know at least what they want. One thing that they're going to get out of this whole process is Gus Malzahn and his offense is finally going to have a viable dual threat quarterback. Not the Jarrett Stidham who might run the ball here and there, and he runs the ball kind of as a decoy, like it or love it. Jarrett Stidham was not the true dual threat quarterback that Gus Malzahn is comfortable with. When I think about dual threat quarterbacks for Auburn, I think about guys like obviously Cam Newton, and Nick Marshall was absolutely explosive as a dual threat quarterback for the Auburn Tigers. So when I think about this, you know, I think all four guys, given their skill set, can be successful in this particular offense. But what I believe is going to come down to, and because you have this game against Oregon, is going to come obviously down to trust. Which guy do we trust the most to run this offense? I mean, that's elementary. The next thing is their level of influence. Who is going to have the most positive influence over the players to accentuate the qualities of all the players involved? Because when you think about Cam Newton and when you think about Nick Marshall, their presence on the field brought their teammates to a whole nother level of play. Is the guy that we choose, does he have that ability to do this? And number three, like I said before, ball protection is going to be very important, especially in a high consequence game like Oregon, because, you know, I have what I like to call those equalizers. Sometimes in a game where, you know, you have an underdog team, those equalizers like the turnovers and the penalties start to kind of even the playing field of certain games. So when I think about that, I honestly don't have a quarterback that I, because I've been watching film on all these guys, and I'm looking at it to where any one of these guys can be effective in variations of what I've seen of Gus Malzahn's offense. But I think it's going to come down to the intangibles, the leadership, the influence, and the ability to protect and be focused and protect the football. Now, I will say this. If Bo Nix, who is one of a highly touted quarterback out of Hoover, Alabama, if he already had a year of experience with the Auburn Tigers because of the command that I see on film of him in high school, I would go out on a limb and say that Bo Nix would be my favorite, because he has qualities of each of the quarterbacks, Cort Sandberg, Malik Willis, and Joey Gatewood. He is like a hybrid of all three of those guys. The only thing he doesn't have, in my opinion, and it's not even an opinion, he just doesn't have it. He doesn't have experience. If Bo Nix had the experience, this wouldn't be a conversation, because I would think that he would be the obvious starter for this offense.
Got to tell you, folks, I'm enjoying the conversation here on Auburn Football. We got Vernon Speak Sports talking Tigers. And please join him here on YouTube as he has been revving up the videos, transferring his content from Facebook now on YouTube. So please join him for some Auburn football talk. We want to remind you that we've got the super chat cranked up. We've got Eli and DeAndre have contributed. And for Eli, I hope you see the link that I put in the live chat there. You wanted my take on Les Miles' move to Kansas and whether he's going to turn around the Jayhawks. I cut 13 solid minutes on that, Eli. I sent you the link, and we talked about Les Miles trying to win in the Big 12. Vernon, as soon as I announced that you were coming on, had a number of Auburn people jump in with some questions and comments, most notably along the trenches, wanting to know whether you're going to be sturdy enough to match up with the powers in the SEC Western Division, both offensively and defensively.
Well, one thing that the Auburn fans can be rest assured is that over the recruiting period, there was some effort to solidify some depth. As a matter of fact, there's been a position change with defensive linemen transferring over to the offensive line to solidify some depth there, because we all know that to compete, especially in the SEC West, that everything is predicated at the line of scrimmage. Obviously, Auburn struggled mightily last season along the line of scrimmage on the offensive side of the football. Returning, you have Kim Caleb, you have Mike Horton, you have Prince Winago, who I think is probably one of the better athletes that I've ever seen as an offensive lineman, Marquel Harrell and Jack Driscoll, Jack Driscoll was actually a transfer from UMass. I actually had the opportunity to look at the film on, you know, really pay attention to the offensive line in the Tennessee game today, because I did a little content on the Tennessee game today. And when I look at the offensive line, it's actually, you know, they were inconsistent at best. Some plays, I mean, look like the best offensive line in the country. Other plays, I mean, just grossly missed assignments. Jarrett Stidham is running for his life. You know, I think now that these guys have some experience under their belt, they had an incredible game against Purdue. They have an excellent coach in J.B. Grimes, who was actually the coach during those successful periods of Gus Malzahn's tenure at Auburn. And I think you will see an improvement in the offensive line this year. And I think they will be a lot more physical. I think they will understand, because Gus Malzahn is the sole play caller. Because you got to think about this too, guys. We want to throw the offensive line under the bus. But you got to think about, you had two equally opposite philosophies going on at one time. You have Chip Lindsey, who wants to do pro style, throw screens, things of that nature. And you have the tempo with Gus Malzahn. And when personnel, this is even on a job, when personnel don't particularly understand what they're being asked to do, there are going to be some confusions. Now, you did see once Gus Malzahn took back over the offense, there was a lot more solidarity. They played with a lot more confidence. You can tell that the offensive line prior to Gus Malzahn calling plays, I mean, they just weren't, they just, you could tell that there was just a lack of, in just the lack of solidarity within their scheme. So when I look forward to the 2018, Gus Malzahn calling plays gives me, I like to use this term, casual optimism as to how this season is going to go. Now, when we talk about the defensive line, now that should get all the Auburn fans fired up. As a matter of fact, I want all the Auburn fans who are on this line to give a like, a share. If you're on the Super Chat, give a donation, because Auburn University War Eagle is in the house tonight, okay? Especially when I talk about this defense, baby. One thing that Auburn...
Preach it, Vernon. I love that. Give it to me.
One thing that Auburn fans had to get excited about is when Derrick Brown, I don't understand why he didn't go. But either way, I'm glad he didn't. But either way, Derrick Brown, All-American defensive lineman, decides to come back. That's another thing that kind of managed my perception of Gus Malzahn and the coaching staff to say, okay, why did he come back? You know, because he could have easily been at least a late first round, early second round pick. I mean, you come back and you have the risk of getting hurt. You have the risk of, you know, something happening to where it ruins your career. You have a bad season that lowers your draft stock. All of those things come to play. But he decides to come back. And that just really quietly ignited the Auburn fan base. Okay. So in addition to Derrick Brown coming back, Marlon Davidson decides to come back. Nick Cole is still there. You got Big Cat Bryant and all of these T.D. Moultrie. Also, Auburn did an excellent job of the recruitment of Charles Moore out of Mississippi. I think he's going to really help add some solidarity to the Auburn defensive line. And he's such a good athlete. I think he has the opportunity to play that buck linebacker position, because you have to be you got to be physical, but you have to be athletic enough to cover the flat, at least the flat. They try not to stretch him out too far past the flat, but Auburn has reason to be very optimistic. Now, I will say this. If those defensive linemen, Marlon Davidson and Derrick Brown, would not have come back, I will go out on a limb and say that Auburn would have had some serious problems, and I'm going to tell you why. The reason Auburn would have had some serious problems is because you're going to have a lot of youth and inexperience at that linebacker position this year for the Auburn Tigers. Now, I will tell you this. Auburn did a good job of recruitment of Owen Papo. I saw Owen Papo in the Under Armour All-Star game, and he made a play that was so incredible. Ironically, his teammate, Bo Nix, was throwing a pass out in the flat, a little bit further than the flat. I'm thinking it's a cornerback that's about to make the pick six. But oh no, it was Owen Papo that was about to pick six Bo Nix out in the flat. That just shows his range. He has such range that he's going to add something to the Auburn linebacker core that they haven't had in such a long time, is elite athleticism. We love Deshaun Davis. You know, I think Deshaun Davis has a heart of gold, and he puts it all on the line. But let's just face it. When it comes to making those elite plays, kind of like that play LSU, when LSU scored that long touchdown, Deshaun Davis was right there in position, but he didn't have the athleticism to make the play. Owen Papo intercepts that ball. A guy like him intercepts that ball. Now, back to the point of the defensive line. The reason why the experience and the leadership on the defensive line is so great is because it's going to help to develop the linebackers. It's going to take a lot of pressure off those linebackers, knowing that they have an experienced defensive front. Now, if they would have had to replace Marlon Davidson and Derrick Brown, then you would have had some serious problems. That return really, really gave Auburn some leverage as to how they can move some guys around. As a matter of fact, Auburn has a defensive end that they recruited out of Loganville, Georgia. His name is Kobe Wooten. He's actually a pretty good ball player as well. I wouldn't necessarily consider him elite, but he would definitely add to the depth of the defensive line. I think, you know, just going out on a limb, I would go out on a limb and say that because of the defensive line returning for Auburn, the offense is actually going to help out a little bit more with time of possession. Because even with a bit as abysmal as Auburn's time of possession was, some games, the Georgia game, 18 minutes of time of possession, you know, and that would do wear and tear on your defense, especially when you're playing against Georgia, who probably had one of the best offensive lines in the SEC. I think with the offense's help and with the defense returning all of this experience and, you know, the elite athleticism at the linebacker position, Auburn is in a position to have a top 5 to 8 defense this year, in my opinion.
So, people, as you join the live chat, keep in mind that we started the live stream tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern time. So we've been going strong here for an hour. So also keep in mind that if, for example, you just want to hear Auburn football talk, that you wait until this entire video processes in post, and you can watch the entire call-in show, hear from a number of viewers, and hear my comments as well. Or we will edit just the Auburn segment, just the West Virginia segment, and coming up the UCLA segment as well, and we will have that available to you as well. If you just want to hear Auburn football, that's going to be posted by tomorrow morning with Vernon Speaks Sports. Please join him on his YouTube channel right here on glorious YouTube. Vernon, we appreciate you stopping by. It's been a great time with you. You're a mecca of insight and information on the Auburn Tigers, and I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. I appreciate you as well. Thank you, Mark. I hope to be back soon.
Vernon, you have a great night. We'll see you soon.
Yes, sir.